Visiting Royalty is our next title of this session, and we're going to speak to them because all of them, of course, are achievers in their own right as well, and they're going to tell us about their story, how they are revitalizing their local heritage, and of course, taking it to the rest of India and also the world. So let me begin with you first, Pushpitaji. Tell us about your story, about how you are preserving and cultivating your heritage today.
Hi, family and friends. It's a very interesting topic, which is very relevant. Okay. Hello, everyone, and Khamagani to all. That's the way we address it. And I just wanted to, it's a very interesting platform that we've come here for, to, you know, after the, you know, the Jamindari system, the collapse, with independence coming, all craft and art needed, patronage. So it had to be the reinvented. You know, earlier, the art and craft and architecture, it was the royal families which patronized it. So the patronage had to change and reinvent with the royalty, with independence, the royalties had to go. And with 1977, the closure of Privy Purse, the locals needed to earn a living. It was so, you know, tourism helped a lot in that sense. And these beautiful heritage properties needed to be revived. So tourism, in a way, when we got more people into our areas, that's how, we had to survive, and the art and craft, the patronage had to change. You know, it had to reach a common man. So to reach a common man, the art and craft had to be revived.
And your personal story, how you've tried to do it?
I was very fond of jewelry. So I thought, and also block printed fabrics for some time. So I thought, I must do jewelry. And I have a very interesting anecdote to share, that jewelry is very fascinating in Rajasthan, which is also very interesting, how the ruling class wears, how the tribals wear. It's the metal is used in so many interesting ways. So it was a local craftsman just told me, I'm not going to design anything in silver for you, because he thought, silver was, it was very fascinating to know that. And that's how I, because I was very interested in jewelry,
yes,
which was a passion, and which turned into a hobby, which turned into a profession. And I could see when I, got my work done from artisans, they were so interested, they were so fascinating. And I really work from the grassroots level.
And as George Bernard Shaw also once said, privileged is a person whose avocation becomes his vocation.
Yeah.
As in his passion, of course, becomes his profession, as it has for you. Let me move on. Meenalji, let's quickly bring you in here into how, according to you, royalty is reinvented and adapted to today's time. And let's hear your personal story about how you've done it in your own way.
I think we are privileged to be born in the families that we are, to be the inheritors of such a beautiful legacy. But it also comes with a sense of responsibility, and the responsibility of preserving it and passing it on to the future generations. To me, I think we are all just custodians, because what we've inherited, a lot of it came through royal patronage. So be it the architecture, be it the crafts, art, the palaces. For us, I think we are custodians, and we just have to look after, try our best to preserve and pass it on. Tourism was, I think, a great step forward for us. Rajasthan, of course, were the pioneers. Odisha is still very, very new to heritage tourism, but some of us are converting now our palaces and havelis into hotels or homestays. So that is one step ahead, to preserve and sort of restore our houses, which is a mammoth task, actually. Also patronizing the local arts and crafts, which actually grew under the royal patronage. So a lot of our ancestors set up a lot of the clusters which are still existing today. So there's Dokra. In Dhenganal, we have the Dokra. We have beautiful handloom. And there's silver filigree. There's Pattachitra. I can go on and on. There's so much. Also the cuisine. So some of these are passed down recipes, which have come through generations. So to showcase that, I think tourism is a great platform. I am working with the local artisans also, trying to give them a platform. So sort of a little bit of design intervention and giving it a modern utility. So be it handloom, be it Dokra. We call our brand Meena Ketan, and we have exhibitions in various parts of the country. We have a little boutique in the palace for our tourists. So yeah, so that's as of now, that's what we are doing. We have also started a foundation towards the artisans and their
local
welfare. Yeah.
Yes, as your ancestors would do, who were patrons of the crafts as well. Okay, let me get in now, Nivriti, to hear your opening comments, of course, on how important it has been for India's royal families, who are truly ambassadors of India as well, abroad, to reinvent, adapt to today's changing times, today's new India, as Prime Minister says as well. And also, what's your personal story on how you've preserved your local crafts, of course, back home in Odisha and now in Rajasthan?
Well, I'm still beginning, but it's a small step that I have taken, and my aunt here, I think, very correctly said that Mewar, as the royal family, has always believed that they are custodians, and they have been patrons of the art over generations. They have encouraged the local people, or you know, people of the land, to basically pursue art, craft, and also music in that way. And in my own little initiative, I basically come from a place called Balangir, which is erstwhile Patna state. And there are six districts around Balangir, including Balangir, which is Bargarh, Sambalpur, Sonpur, Baud, and one or two more, where Sambalpuri Ikkat is woven, and it's a handloom craft. Now, this Sambalpuri Ikkat is what I'm bringing back to Mewar and turning them into accessories and, you know, travel luggage boxes and even apparels for that matter. The whole idea is that Sambalpuri Ikkat has always been looked at as saris, kurta, salwar kameezes, kurtas for men, maybe, you know, little frocks or shirts for kids. But they've never been used in a way that can showcase to the world that this fabric has more facets to it than just being worn, wrapped around you to cover you with. And that's what the initiative is all about. It's my brand is called Votary, which is a sacred vow. And it's a vow that I have taken to the land that I've been born into and the land that I'm married into. And the aim is to try and amalgamate both, you know, Orissa and Mewar, and try and create little pieces of treasure. The USP of the brand is that because these fabrics are hand woven, and they are only woven, maximum 12 meters of cloth is woven at a go. So you have very limited pieces. So every piece is a limited edition, and that is the USP of it.
Amazing. Also, you know, just talking now about how much of a role our royal families play in tourism as well, and tourism attracting, of course. And I'm sure you see a lot of that in Udaipur. Do you believe we're doing enough to preserve and conserve our palaces, our forts, and promote them to get in tourism to India?
Well, yeah, I have to go back a little in time, because in the 60s, when my grandfather-in-law, Maharana Bhagwat Singh Ji, he basically turned Lake Palace into under their wings, it is only then that they ventured out of Bombay. And to keep maintain them and to for their upkeep, it is important to have them generate income for themselves.
So truly leading from the front.
Absolutely,
there.
Absolutely, and a pioneer in his...
And I'm sure you're very proud of being in that very, very family. Let's speak about your views on the topic as well, Meenuji. And how much...
Just start off straight away. But I think Odisha was not ready for tourism yet. And it's been 34 years of struggling and getting out there. But now, yes, I think tourism has opened up. Odisha is a new destination. It is India's best kept secret, I feel. There are a lot more tourists coming in. To give you a small example, there's a small town called Manya Bandho, which weaves ikat, both cotton and silk. And no one had really heard of Manya Bandho. And today it's the most visited village, craft village of 2024. So, that's a bit of a step over there. And we are trudging along, but there's still a lot to be done. So Odisha still needs to improve on its infrastructure.
Yeah.
And I think each of us have to take that in. We still don't even have a policy for tourism, for heritage tourism in Odisha. So, we do have to put our act together still.
I will take the point from Nivriti's family, the House of Mewar. And because I handled Arvind Singh Ji's media for over 5 years. And I saw...
So it's all in the family here. You've handled Arvind Singh Ji's media. Meenuji is your aunt, so clearly all in the family. But this was not planned. Unless the audience thinks it's a...
No,
you know,
we are all related. And it was... you'll find a connect.
And Arvind Hukum Shri Ji, as we address him, Shri Ji was, he was such a wonderful person, is such a wonderful person. He patronized and he made sure he took up Gajneer, which is his nanihal, his maternal. So he took up Gajneer. Yeah, I'm talking of Bikaner, where my husband comes from. So, Gajneer is a beautiful property. And, he spread his wings. And, he did fabulous. He took up properties. He built a beautiful property in Jaisalmer, the fort palace where Satyajit Ray's film was shot. So that city, even there. So, giving employment to so many people was his motive. I mean, he discussed with me, ki Pushpita, I want to be Annadata in the true sense that, we have to create jobs for, our local people, which was, everything. It was so fascinating. And, compared, when you talk of food, that, I also did, even Rajasthan, which is bereft of any green vegetables. The food was, but it's so interesting to, hear about the food that you could fill a platter, a full thali.
Of course, yes, that's another thing. The food is also, Indian food has also been patronized by the royal family. Okay, it's time to end now, but I can't end without a short anecdote. Wo kehte na bachpan mein kahaniyan hoti thi, jo sabne suni hongi, raja aur raniyon ki. To aaj hamare beech hain, to khud inhi se sun lete hain, ek choti si kahani. Perhaps about your kingdom, erstwhile kingdom, or about another royal tale that you'd like to, in short, share with us. And it's very correct what you said, because when we see, of course, Dua Lipa at City Palace in Jaipur, or we see Mick Jagger, at Umaid Bhavan, then foreigners also want to come to these places. But yes, very quickly, a story that you'd like to share with us.
I had the privilege of meeting Hollywood stars in Udaipur, Owen Wilson and Nicole Kidman. The film Darjeeling Mail was being shot. Was being shot. And Nicole Kidman and Owen Wilson, were there. I rubbed shoulders with them. I'm very proud to share. And, films were being shot. Because Udaipur has got such beautiful nuggets, gems. Wow. The beautiful vintage car museum. So, it is very interesting.
Hollywood, of course, rubbing shoulders with Indian royalty. Meenuji, very quickly, a short story.
I'll tell you a funny thing. So there's no similarity between Gujarat and Odisha. And Gujarat, so Russia, is where I came from. The language was alien, the customs, the food habits, the climate. I could have been on Mars. And the only similarity, the only word I could pick up was Gujarati. So when they were making tea for me, I was all of 4 or 5 days married. They said, "Teen char Gujarati," or I understood, "Teen char Gujarati dal do chai mein." And I said, "Oh my God, this is the Sas Bahu drama now starting off. Gujarati in the chai." Then my mother-in-law and my sister-in-law realized the horror on my face and said that Gujarati is Elaichi actually in Odia. So from that day onwards, now Gujarati is referred to as Elaichi. So I have managed to change that.
Ab to Gujaratis are ruling the country. You can't, teen char Gujarati koi nahi dalega chai mein. Ek chai wala hi desh ko aaj chala raha hai.
Absolutely, you have to clap on this.
Sangeeta ji, sorry, beg your pardon. Sangeeta ji is of course your mother, Nivriti ji.
It's my honor to be known by her name. But I think just to take the cue from my aunt again.
And in fact, your mother is with us as well today. Member of Parliament, Sangeeta ji, welcome. Thank you for being with us. Yes.
So when we were getting married, my husband and I were getting married, my father-in-law and my father came up with this idea that we must put the Rajpurohits of both the families together. And just to discuss that, what are the, you know, common, the similar customs that we have, or the different customs that are there, and which ones we should keep and which ones we can sort of, you know, adjust a little bit with, because both sides are very, very particular about keeping up with customs and traditions. And that's when we were very pleasantly surprised that even though we come from two extreme ends of the country, they were just known by different names, but our customs and traditions were almost the same. And you know, one of the funny things that happened during the wedding is that when my husband arrived and my mother had to do the sasu aarti, and of course everyone was standing together, and we have this way of trying to ward off evil, which is known as the hula huli, the hulhuli, as they call it. Even the Egyptians have it, and I have not been, I mean, I'm still being teased about it, because they got such a fright, I think, the Rajasthanis, that where was this strange noise coming from, because every time something auspicious was happening, and all the ladies would start doing the hula huli again. So that is a fun fact.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you so much. And if you want to discover more of these fun facts, you've got to visit their places, of course, that they've spoken about, and support their brands, that, as they are saying, they're supporting their local artisans too. Thank you very much to the three of you for being with us. And you are truly brand ambassadors of India. Let's hope you continue that legacy forward in able hands.
Absolutely. And before we let you go, here's a small token of appreciation.